what I've experienced, I've spent 6 years in teaching students and many years doing other stuff in nursing and other areas. And one of the things I used to tell my students was, you know, as sophisticated, as technical, as sexy, as all the technical stuff in the ICUs and the CCUs and the this and that, the most important tool that you have to use with any patient is yourself. Mm-hmm. And that's a lesson that I learned at Hopkins, and a lesson that I tried to carry through, and it doesn't always get taught. You get kind of, you know, blown away by all the gadgetry and all the stuff that can, sophisticated stuff, unbelievable stuff. But the most important tool that you have is yourself. So that's my contribution. And
well, I would say that we were a unique group of women, first of all. I mean, I think we were all leaders before we came to Hopkins. I think someone told us that all of us were in the top 10% of our classes, our graduating classes from high school. So everybody came very well prepared, you know, to learn. But I think that our generation, when we grew up, we were also very independent. Our parents didn't coddle us, you know, like the current generation of parents do. We didn't have helicopter parents. My mother never knew where I was half the time, you know. But so I think that we were very mature, and we were ready for that experience, and we just welcomed it and we embraced it, and we made the most of it. And I think that we came out extremely well prepared. I know I felt extremely. I went to work at Barnes in St. Louis, and I just took charge of a whole unit. You know, I had this orthopedic post-surgical unit, and then I had another that was the higher up, the really nice part of the hospital, where I was also responsible for both units. And I was the only nurse that had that dual responsibility. I had to give all my own meds, do all my own treatments. And after I'd been there for about 5 months, I went to the head nurse, and I'm like, okay, I'm understanding that the other nurses on the other shifts, that they don't have to give them all meds. They don't take it. They're not responsible for two units. And she said, but you can do it. You know, she said, you're prepared, and they're not. And I found that time and again, that the preparation we had was so outstanding, and I'm so grateful.
I said, I've worked in different places, and the first thing, when you say you're from Hopkins, people sort of applaud. I mean, they don't applaud, they just go, oh, wow. It still carries weight on both sides of the coast.
Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons I think that we got our first jobs was that we were Hopkins nurses. I was offered a job in an intensive care unit right out of nursing school, and new grads didn't do that. And I'm sure that it was because I was a Hopkins grad. Mm-hmm. So the name and leadership that we were taught is really important.
Exactly. It's the same thing that happened to me. I walked into every interview on Long Island that I went to, accepted me because of the Hopkins name. I'm fairly certain of that. And the same thing with the ICU. I'm a brand new nurse, you can't put me in ICU. And ICU was just starting.
Yes, exactly.
So it was, and they said, Hopkins, you can do it. And that's how everybody thought, I think.
Yeah.
And besides that, the friendships that we made, you know, the way Hampton House was run. And,
not run.
But it was an amazing experience.
Also, at the time we were interviewed and applied, they sort of tried to discourage us from going to a 3-year program because the bachelors were just going into being. But I've never regretted it.
Right.
I'm always glad that I did listen to Dr. Courtney and whoever else interviewed us.
I think that one of the things that just strikes me, and we've all worked in a lot of different places, but going from Hopkins to lots of other hospitals and different situations, I don't think that the words critical thinking were buzzwords in 1969, but I think if they weren't, we started it. Because
yes.
I think that, you know, that's what separated, that I felt separated us from when I went to a different job. I can remember thinking, you know, somebody was trying to teach me how they did things there, and it was A, B, C, and if I asked why, it was because we've always done it that way.
Mm-hmm.
And for us, that wasn't a good enough answer. It's like, but if you think about it, you could do it better this way.
Right.
And they were like, not really. We're doing it this way because that's how we've always done it. So I think the critical thinking part, it was expected from us, I think,
mm-hmm.
But I don't think, like I said, it was a buzzword, but I think that's what it boiled down to. I think that's what we're all saying.
I was just saying, don't think there were many other student nurses anywhere who were taught to challenge doctors, but we were. Exactly. If we saw something wrong, we didn't agree with something, we were taught to ask and to participate in the patient's care by talking to doctors and asking them. And nowhere else, or no other nurses at that time were taught that. I mean, you just
stood up.
Yeah, yeah.
May I ask a question, Dr. Gabriel? But at Hopkins, we were taught to think for ourselves and to use our heads.
I got a job with the Baltimore City Health Department, and they never hired diploma grads, ever. But since I came from Hopkins, I got a job right away. And I remember one of the women, one of the other nurses early on, asked me one day, where did you go to school? I said, Johns Hopkins. She says, you act like a Hopkins nurse.
Was it an insult?
Thank you.
Well, from her, it was probably an insult, I learned later. But then I worked in the health department on the Eastern Shore. And to carry on with what you said, the nurses all stood up when the doctor walked in the room. And it was like, what are you all doing? Why are you standing up? And it was, I had a lot of teaching to do to give these women some self-assurance of, you know, you don't do that as a nurse, really. You're a professional.
As students, I remember being in the Wilmer Eye Institute, and we had to stand at the end of the patient's bed when the doctors made rounds. Mm-hmm. And that was the first time that I started to think about feminism, because I was so annoyed.
Well, I had an instructor in pediatrics who insisted that we clean off the bed top tables, and I mean, she was an old-fashioned
Well, that was
nurse.
Everywhere. You always had to clean.
We
had to clean
nurses.
The beds when the patient was discharged.
Yeah, they were all.
We stripped the beds
nurses.
And we had to clean with whatever.
That we learned something from them. Yeah, you're right. They were
we had to clean. I'm probably different from a lot of you because I only stayed in nursing for 6 years or so. But I remember my very first job, University of Pennsylvania. I walked in, they saw my credentials. Good, we need a charge nurse for 11 to 7.
Oh, yeah.
Right out of school. And of course, I wanted the money. I said, sure, I can do that. I lasted 4 weeks, I think. They put me at night, 11 to 7. Aides were there to help me. It was an open bed situation where you look this way, that way. IVs going without pumps. You had to count the drops.
Oh,
I'm thinking, I'm the only one to hang an IV bag, to give the medicines, to give the injections, check vitals, check wounds. I said, I can't do all of this. And the night nurse or whoever supervisor would say, sure, you're from Hopkins. Look at your cap. Remember, the caps made us stand out. And that was still back in the day where we were wearing the white uniforms and the hats and the shoes and the white stockings. Sure, I can do this. I remember going home crying. Getting on that subway saying, Lord, how many IVs ran dry on me? How many did I speed up too fast? It was, but it made me realize that I did have great training from Hopkins. But after a while, I said, this is not fair. I need another nurse. I can't be the only nurse from 11 to 7. This is crazy. But anyway, that's my story.
My first job was at Grady Hospital in Atlanta, which is a big teaching hospital.
Yay, I know Grady.
Yeah. And when I first walked in, right away, the head nurse said, good, I'm taking off for the weekend. You're in charge. And so I remember they were going to send up a couple of patients from the ER. And I said to them, the floor is locked, because we had everybody, all the beds were filled. And they said, locked? What are you talking about? I said, I don't have any beds. They said, well, find some. So I had to decide what patients to send to different areas of the hospital, you know, so I could accept these new patients. But the other thing that really struck me was we had some, this one patient who had terrible leg ulcers. And I went in and I did the Mary Farr technique.
Ooh.
I just scrubbed those legs out and it healed those, her ulcers. I mean, the doctors came in and they were astounded. They said, how did you do that? And I said, it's the Mary Farr technique.
It still works.
And it still works. I mean, you know, I always think about that even today, you know, to scrub things out, you know, and get it good.
I never left Hopkins, so.
totally boring, you know, never went to any of those other places. So being a Hopkins nurse wasn't necessarily special. And there was a first day where we were in orientation. We were all in whites for the first time. And we went down to the cafeteria. We were in an orientation, so we had some free time. Went to the cafeteria, and there was two tables of us. Does anybody else remember this? And Clyde Schellenberger, who was the chaplain, you remember him?
Oh, yes.
He walked in, and people around us started clapping. It's a,
oh, yeah. Yeah.
Is this another one of those memories that's just mine?
Since Sandy brought up Reverend Schellenberger, I had forgotten what a gem he was.
Yeah.
What a all, I think many of us were touched by him and by his presence.
He was always there.
He was always there, you know, for us, for patients, for physicians. And I'm so glad you brought his name up because I would not have pulled it out. So that's one of the really fine memories I have. The other thing is that, going back to, I think something Barb said, about we were all told that we should maybe look at a baccalaureate program when we came here. Well, I remember being so ill-prepared and did not have the knowledge to really understand the import of that statement. And I, like a lot of us, I'm sure, had to go back afterwards and jump through the hoops of getting the BSN and so on and so forth. And I remember when I went back for my BSN, and I was in Louisiana at the time, having to pay to take classes from people who had very poor knowledge. And I had to be subjected to going through those hoops in order to earn something that, you know, when I looked back, I went, well, maybe I should have, maybe I would have been better having done the BSN at first. But I agree with Barb. I think not. I think everything I needed to learn about nursing, I learned here. And I went on and got an MSN, and they didn't teach me a thing that I didn't already learn here. I learned how to be a nurse here. And so, you know, I've had some times of going back and forth with that opinion, but I think this is where I think we all were formed.
Do you all remember our senior rotations where we were in charge of the floor and where we learned all these things? Our patient, we didn't have an ICU. I mean, we didn't. Our patients were all ICU patients, or, you know, and when they got really sick, they, in surgery, that Hall said, they'd ship them to Osler to straighten them out. I mean, our patients were all critically ill. If you could do that, and I remember in my first job in an emergency department in a big city, I mean, people would say, oh my God, I can't do this. I'm like, I mean, because you just did it. I mean, I don't, not saying it was right, wrong, or whatever, but if you could get through here, you certainly could manage at many other hospitals. And my students, to the day I retired, you know, just said, Dr. Ellis, are you that old? They didn't have ICUs?
No, they didn't have
ICUs. I said, we didn't have respiratory therapy. They were just thinking I was, like, getting senile, you know. It's about time for me to retire.
I'm sitting here thinking, and I might get teary, about Mary Farr and Osler. And I worked at Osler after I graduated. But even though Mary Farr focused on getting the corners right, she placed value on the smallest things that we did. And I think it made nursing really important, and that we left here valuing those everything that we did, because everything affected the patient and nothing was too small to do the right way. So this is a shout out to Mary.
I left here and I was a camp nurse, and this is sort of like going to sound funny, because I'm thinking, oh, I'm this Hopkins grad, so I'm going to be a camp nurse. And the first jellyfish bite, the kids had to tell me what to do. but it was a great learning experience. And then I went back to York, and I was on a med-surg floor and was immediately a team leader.
And again, that was like, you know, I don't even know what I'm doing, you know, but oh, well, you can be a team leader. Okay. But when I came back to Baltimore and I worked in the Baltimore area, I did not work at Hopkins. No, I did work at Hopkins for a while. Then I moved away and I did not work at Hopkins. And I learned that, and this is going to sound negative, and I don't mean it to sound negative, but when you work in the Baltimore area at another hospital, you're not seen as anything special and almost seen as, oh, well, what do you think you are, you know? So I had to learn to sort of deal, because I was so proud of everything that I did. And that was a different experience other than that, because I still felt that we all could work circles around anybody. But the thing that I cherish most, and it's not the nursing education as much as the living education of being in a dorm and being with people and learning to live as a community, which not many people had that experience. And we were a smaller group, and we all were going through such major emotional issues and learning. We were 18 years old and learning what, you know, we probably shouldn't learn at 18 years old. So I was telling somebody today that when I would go home, like at Christmas, and I'd get together with my high school friends, they all seemed so immature. Because they were just going to college and going to parties, although we did that too. But nothing can account for the closeness that we all feel. And here we are, like 50 years later, and everybody's not been to every reunion, but we get together and it's like we never separated. Mm-hmm. And I came back to Hopkins to get my bachelor's. And with the new programs, the way they are, nobody lives in a dorm. Nobody has that sense of community that I could sense. And I just felt sad that these people would not get that same experience.
Well, this kind of goes to what Kathy was just saying. We had such fun together in the dorm when we weren't studying and working. When I remember one time that there are a few people on the sixth floor that didn't have dates, so we had to make some fun for ourselves. So we dragged furniture out of the lounge areas and we put them in the elevators and furnished the elevators. Yes. And it was hilarious because some people would come back from their dates, they take the elevator up to their floor and get out and not even realize they were sitting on a couch all the way up on the elevator. It never even dawned on them. And one time we took one girl's furniture out of her room and put it in the hallway, complete with the posters on the wall. And she came back from her date and I thought she was going to explode on us. But we just had such fun doing stuff like that. I mean, it was innocent fun, but I mean, we're just like the closest friends now today. And it was all because we got to live in Hampton House those 3 years. It was wonderful. I've really enjoyed it.
Okay. I don't know who in the group started it, but there was a way to trick the sandwich machine to give out free sandwiches. So we ate pretty good. We went down to that basement. Then somebody else showed us how to make phone calls.
Yeah.
You do something with the trigger and the operator would say, that'll be, I don't know, 50 cents. Mm-hmm. And we do something, and all of a sudden, 50 cents was showing on the operator side. So we got a call. Yeah, free. Yes, indeedy. But I guess they took the sandwich machine out.
Yeah.
Because I think they finally realized that there was no money in the hopper. Sandwiches were gone. But there was not enough money to account for what they put in. I don't know what they finally did with the phone system, though.
We were talking today about the way we all got together and had such good times. Apparently that moving the furniture out of the room was a prank that every floor was to play. Because I don't know how many times we moved everybody's furniture up to the roof, to various places around. When Midge was out one time on a date, we spent the whole evening crumpling up newspaper and throwing it in her room. During that time, I lost my boyfriend's ring that I had, so that was a big problem. I had to go through all that newspaper again. And then we were talking about how we used to go in kind of inappropriate garb over to the pizza parlor. We put a raincoat over our pajamas and all kinds of stuff and run over to the pizza parlor. So we did have good times. There certainly was some stress too, studying mm-hmm. for things, but we got through that too, because hey, we're all here now and we've all made a successful career out of some version of nursing, I think. Mm-hmm. And like everyone else, I think the first job that I had, virtually after 2 months, they said to me, I think you could go down to the ED and run that. And I was like, I don't think that would be appropriate, but hey, that's the kind of thing they thought you could do because you had that kind of education. Mm-hmm. So it's been a great place to have grown up.
I just wanted to bring up the race riots, what we went through during that time and how amazing that was that, you know, we staffed the hospital because we could get through the tunnel and get over to the hospital, and the regular staff couldn't get in because they had everything blocked off. The National Guard was camped on the median between the Hampton House and the hospital, on the roof. And, you know, we were watching buildings burn out there and people looting from the shops. What was that road right there?
Gay Street.
Gay Street.
Was on fire.
And we pulled it off. I mean, we staffed that hospital for them while regular staff couldn't come in. But it was a frightening time. And we couldn't be in our rooms because our rooms were on the outer, the ones who had rooms that were on the street side. We had to move into the hallway. Remember, Bev, we had to sleep in the hall?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because we couldn't, they were afraid they were gonna blow the windows in. And it was quite a frightening time.
I remember that day because Theda and I had picked that day for some reason to walk all the way downtown and go shopping. And on the way back, we were wondering why there was such a commotion going on all the, because you remember how far it was and we had to walk through all the different neighborhoods. And we were wondering why there was such a lot of commotion going on out there. And when we finally got in, people said to us, oh my God, they sent the police out for you. There's riots going on. And a few minutes later, I tell you that everything broke out around that time. But on the positive side, nobody harassed us in any way. I'm sure they thought, those two people must be from Hopkins or something, students from Hopkins, because I don't think many other people just wandered through all neighborhoods like that, so.
Okay, I have to say too, it wasn't the riots, but just the race, the whole race issue. When we were in public health, I never felt unsafe going anywhere in Baltimore. I don't know if everyone felt that way, but no matter what, I think we were treated with respect, and that was an important thing to learn, because when I went back to New York, it wasn't the same. In New York City, I would have been afraid, you know, but down there, it wasn't. The worst thing that happened to me was I fell through a wooden stairs on one of the row houses, but that was it. And everybody else, I never had any fear of going into any section, which the projects, anything, which I think was very important at the time.
Yeah.
You know, it made me respect a lot of people in a different way.
Mm-hmm. I had broken my ankle right before my community health rotation in our senior year. And so I was on crutches in the projects. And nobody ever bothered me. And I felt a huge respect for those people.
Exactly.
And I carried that all the way through my life. But the other thing is about 50 years ago is that was a heck of a year with Bobby Kennedy and Martin Luther King. And Woodstock, and it was just an amazing, amazing year for a lot of turmoil and sadness.
I'm saying that we reached out to the community. Gene Brinkley and some other people in here were part of the Baltimore Tutorial Project. We went down, we mentored kids from elementary on up, and we would bring them to Hampton House to show them how we lived and take them out to lunch and those kinds of things. So we did reach out to the community. And we also, I remember trying to reserve my 12 o'clock, we got certain curfews, and we only had a certain number per month. But I would babysit for money, and I hated it when these people came home after midnight, because I only got 50 cents an hour. They bring all the kids to one house.
Yeah.
Then meanwhile, you got 50 cents an hour, keeping 10 children, and you lost your 12 midnight. So that was interesting. And also on the sixth floor, we are part of a special group up there.
Yeah.
There were three phones, one on north, south, and central.
Yep.
One time I was on all three. But it was fun. It was fun growing up on the sixth floor in Hampton House.
Betty brought up something I was gonna bring up is how close each floor was. I mean, I was on the fourth floor and I still send and get Christmas cards from the people on the fourth floor. I know the sixth floor is pretty, you know, when there was third floor, everybody on the floor still is pretty friendly and
tight.
Yeah. That's the word.
Yeah.
No matter where we live, it's and we're all scattered all over the place. We're still have those memories and those friendships.
I have one more thing about the closeness of the people on the floor. I remember Carol Curry coming into my room. When I got Murray Farr, I packed my suitcase. I was going home. I did not want to have Miss Farr. But Carol talked me into staying, and you can make it. You made it this far. And I thank God for her.
She wasn't that scary.
She was scary.
Yes, she was.
Oh, Lord, yes.
I had Osler Four twice. Junior, senior year is my first rotation. I thought that was the end of my nursing school career. I got started out with Mary Farr. And then my senior year, my team leading was on Osler Four, and Mary Farr was there. And she didn't slack off on me just because I was in team leading. Oh no, she expected the same amount of work for me and excellence for me as she did when I was younger. But she taught me to be a good bedside nurse, to take care of the patient, to see the patient as a person, see their needs outside of their diagnosis, as a person who had all these problems. And I learned that from Mary Farr, and I don't see that in a lot of younger nursing graduates. They look at the disease, the orders, the meds, what to do, and something gets lost in that. Something gets lost.
I'm so glad.
Yeah. And also, I started out my rotations in the women's and women's center. Remember that? The long wards, beds, and here I'm in my brown lab coat, and I'm sure these patients were looking at me like, are you the housekeeper with the brown shoes on and brown lab coat? And here I'm going around making beds. I'm sure they thought I was the housekeeper. And I thought, is this nursing? But it was the beginning of nursing.
I think it bears noting that we were the first class to go to the university on the bus, remember? And we also didn't have to work weekends, right? Is that true? But one thing that I remember about going to the university is that we were in this English class.
What was her name?
Miss Shopper.
Right.
English writing.
And at one point, she really, I don't think she thought much of us, but at one point she made a comment about Gone with the Wind and how
Scarlet
was just kind of a loser character. It wasn't a very good book. And Charlie was so outraged. I love that book, she said. The other thing that happened is we had the sociology course, right? And we had to do...
And a psych.
Well, we had psych too, but we had sociology. And Peg Cushman and I did this ridiculous but fun project taking photographs of people in the neighborhood. And interviewing.
Taking photographs with.
In the neighborhood. We went all the way down to the docks, I think. And so anyway, those are only just the tip of the iceberg of my memories.
Working, not working weekends or nights. That was a big thing because we were the first class, as Susan said. But the other classes didn't appreciate that. The classes, because they were still doing it, I think, right?
Yes.
Well, we were getting off and they were coming off duty on 7 o'clock in the morning or whatever. So that wasn't, and I think we got longer vacations also.
I wanted to add about the times that we lived in, and that was about the beginning of when abortions were being done at the hospital. And although we didn't get assigned abortion patients, I don't know why, but we didn't. Occasionally, I would hear a patient call, nurse, nurse, and the nurses would ignore these women. And frequently, they would have their fetuses in the bed unattended because I went in to find out what was going on, and here was this poor woman not knowing what to do. And so it really affected me how mean, and that's the word, it was in my head, the nurses were toward these women who didn't do anything wrong. They just had an abortion.
So I just want to talk a little bit about the friendships that we made, that we were talking about. And so there's six or seven of us from sixth floor who've gotten together, not only at our reunions every 5 years, but we've gotten together in Washington, D.C., San Francisco, Maine,
Las Vegas.
Florida.
Florida,
yes. So five other places where we've gone and spent a week together. And every time we see each other, it's just like We were right gone up for the weekend. It's been fabulous. And one other thing, I may be the only person in this room who stopped at her diploma. I never got any further because I ended up marrying somebody in the military. We moved every couple of years and it was really hard. And I had kids, et cetera. But it has never, ever stopped me from getting a job. All you had to do was mention Hopkins. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've been all over the United States and you just mentioned Johns Hopkins and it's like, well, can you start yesterday? Pretty much, essentially. So anyway, no regrets.
Okay. I remember being in Marlboro, which is supposedly the richy side, mm-hmm. well-to-do white people, where the rest of the hospital was African Americans. Mm-hmm. Two times I was there, and I don't know why, but the first time it was someone from Europe, and Hopkins was doing a sex change operation on this particular person.
Yes.
So it was really hush, hush, hush. But whoever allowed me to be this person's nurse, it was a man from wherever, he was white with loads of money, and he had his partner also there. And I remember coming out of the room saying, do I tell anybody? I need to talk about this. What are they doing and why are they doing it? And they said, no, you can't say a word. Then another time I'm walking and I'm in the Marlboro area and my badge had my last name. I had married Latier. And this little richy lady who was white looked at me and said, I don't understand your skin color. I don't understand your name. Who are you, what are you, and why are you my nurse? I'm just like, huh? I'm supposed to be here. And whatever instructor I had kind of went in and said, we'll reassign you. Which later, when I'm thinking about it, it was like, I will reassign you. Because she thought I was very unhappy. Versus she should have gone to the patient to say, you may have money, this is a private room for you, and et cetera, but this is your nurse. But she didn't do that.
So when I was at Barnes as a graduate nurse, and I was the only white nurse on the unit. And I mean, I got to be so close with, my coworkers, and I had several patients who would say, they'd call me in and they'd say, I don't want the black nurses taking care of me. And I would say, then you'll have to leave because we do not have adequate staffing for me to come in and take care of you when I have all these other duties. And I said, I'll call a hospital administrator and you can go to another mm-hmm. floor or you can just go home. Because this is the way this floor is run. And these nurses are excellent nurses and they're as well trained as anyone else. And you're gonna get good care and that's what you're here for. So that's the way it's gonna be. And they accepted it. But it was difficult for the nurses. But I just told them, I said, just go in and do your job. Don't let them intimidate you. This is, and it was kind of sad that, we did live in that era.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And
I was not going to bring this up, but the can has been open now. Not only was it difficult here in 66 when I went, but there was a lot of prejudice, especially in Marlboro. I was there twice. Yeah. There were certain rooms I couldn't go in. And one of the nurses said to me, why are you here? Hopkins is scraping the bottom of the barrel. But you didn't need help. Oh, yes. It was quite difficult. And I would go to some rooms. They would call the nurse and they didn't want the black student nurse taking care of them. So it was not only was it hard, but you had another layer that you had to put up with.
Did you feel like your friends or your classmates
supported you?
I could talk to certain of my classmates, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But again, when you're in that situation, you feel like you're all by yourself, especially if you don't have someone like your instructor saying, look, let's talk about it. I'm going to do this, Y, Z.
Yeah.
But they probably were so busy taking care of their numbers to make sure what they were supposed to do. And probably we did not have any kind of racial discussion in our classes. I don't think we had such. We had nothing about diversity. It just wasn't there.
You should be doubly congratulated.
Okay,
just sticking
thank you.
It out. Really. It wasn't easy.
It was a challenge, but we wanted the challenge. That's why we left our little cities and came up here.
Yeah.
Because,
I'm glad you did. Yeah.
I just want to say that I'm really impressed with the diversity of the Hopkins School of Nursing. And I was talking to one white woman and one African-American nurse. They were both nursing students this afternoon. And they were saying that Hopkins puts as a priority for a diverse community of students mm-hmm. from all over the country. Wow. And I think now. And I think that's really impressive. I didn't find out how many males they have, but their diversity is really incredible. Because I used to teach in a school of nursing, and we were just trying so hard to get a diverse body of students, and it's Hopkins has really done a great job.
I think there's, you know, we lived in, you know, adding to some of the interesting time. I mean, do you all remember? We all ate in the cafeteria 3 meals a day. You know, there really was no variation in that. But then the other rule was you couldn't wear pants right. when you went to the hospital. You know, that was, you know, so it was challenging, you know, and when you think about infection control today, I mean, there was no reason to change out of a uniform that you had used in your clinical situation to go have dinner, you know, and then you'd come back and change your clothes. So it really, it added something to just think about the attitude and some of the restrictions that we had in terms of how we had to appear in public in the hospital mm-hmm. and how we were representing the School of Nursing by not wearing something as innocent as pants. Mm-hmm. Do you remember the horror when they did the fashion show of the new uniforms when we were seniors and they were bringing out the change and they actually were going to have almost like a scrub attire and they actually had pants as part of that uniform design.
We didn't until you brought it up. I didn't, now I remember that.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, we hadn't been able to wear pants in the hospital and then they were designing a uniform and getting away from the brown Oxfords and, you know, the regular, you know, neutral hose that we wore. No duty booties. You know, just think about some of those other memories of, you know, the week before graduation and the white shoelaces that, you know, kind of, you know, we didn't have a stripe or anything to put on our cap, but, you know, how we tried to distinguish ourselves as being so close to graduating. That, you know, that kind of stands out to me. And then the shoes on the fence, day of graduation.
I remember, and maybe you all do too, in our senior year, I remember I had team leading as my second to the last rotation, and then it was gonna be psych. So we were gonna stop wearing our uniforms. And that last day, all of us either hemmed our uniforms really short, or we cut, we you know, basically added a lot of stuff, and we went to work like that. And administration kept calling Mrs. Chichester, our instructor, to get us to change our clothes, and she never answered. We did the whole day like that, and we told our patients why we looked like this, you know, that suddenly we were whatever. And they loved it, and they said, good for you, you know, like, this is our last day of wearing our shoes. Does anybody else remember that?